Venezuelan products to the bakery. We have the traditional dead bread, which is a buttered bread with sugar coating, and these are like little bones that symbolize the bones of the dead. And these little faces are, and they have colors because they remember our people who passed away with joy. And this is the conchas, which are the little transnational shells. And they have a sugar coating, and I think this is the most, probably the most popular bread in Mexico that we have every day with a hot chocolate in the morning or in the evening.
Thank you very, very much to the MUT for providing us with the space. We are eternally grateful. Thank you very much to Catherine West, who is MP and Shadow Minister for Foreign Affairs, Foreign and Commonwealth Affairs. Thank you to Francisco Dominguez, who's a senior lecturer at Middlesex University and Secretary of the Venezuela Solidarity Campaign. And thank you to Jeremy Corbyn, who you might know is the leader of the Labour Party. Maybe you know that, maybe you don't. Thank you very much, Jeremy, for being here with us tonight. My name is Lila Caballero. I am a member of Justice Mexico Now, and I'm going to move over here because I think that Katrina is our lovely Katrina that was cutting my face off. So Justice Mexico Now is an organization of Mexicans and non-Mexicans working towards raising awareness of the human rights situation that Mexico is undergoing. And we are always welcoming people to join us, to support us, to support our campaign. And at the end of the talk, I will, of course, mention our Twitter handle, Facebook group. So please do come over, say hi, and get involved. And so this evening, we are here, as you can see from the altar, and probably if you've been around to the food section and had a taste of the lovely Day of the Dead bread, Mexico is a country of contrasts, and we have very rich traditions, delicious food, very nice weather, especially when it's so dark outside, you appreciate that. But so we maintain traditions from pre-Hispanic times, like the Day of the Dead, for example, where we welcome our deceased relatives, loved ones, friends, to come and celebrate with us once more, once a year. And instead of being afraid of them, we offer them food, drinks, their favorite items, to be with us once again and be a family and be friends. But Mexico is also a country that has very, very dark periods and very dark lows, so to speak. It's a country that has one of the highest records of violence. If you take Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, those countries that are undergoing civil war at the moment, Mexico is perhaps the most violent one. Official records, for example, show that there are nearly 30,000 disappeared, and those are just official records. Imagine all those that are never documented, that are never recorded or registered. So many of you here will probably see or know both sides of the coin, so the nice and beautiful Mexico, but also the dark and not so nice Mexico. But for those of you who don't know it, that's what we're here for. And we're here to kind of give you a taste of what it is that we are fighting for as Justice Mexico Now. And exploring. So yes, we like to criticize and we like to bring up all the horrible things that are happening, but we also want to come up with solutions. We want to try and be propositional so as to how we can all work towards a better future for Mexico and Mexicans, mainly for Mexicans. So I guess with the help of my three speakers this evening, we're going to try and tease this out. So I guess maybe the place to start to my three speakers, and feel free to jump in whoever wants to do this first, is I'd like to ask you what comes to mind when you think of Mexico? Catherine, maybe?
What comes to mind for me is the connection between Mexico and the States, because obviously the history of those borders were quite different many years ago. And if you travel to parts of the south of the US with all those Spanish names, you soon realize it's because originally that wasn't the United States of America. But I think that connection, and I think for us here in London, as a London Member of Parliament, the sense of migration and change, because we know that there is a very strong link between Mexicans who live in the States, and from certainly from a Labour point of view, a Labour movement point of view, the struggle for basic rights, be they workers' rights, be they rights to education, health, and a basic income, and that's often found to be lacking in migrant communities.
They modernized the country so dramatically with one of the most advanced constitutions in the history of humanity up to that point. And this gave the possibility for Mexico to actually develop as a national reality. And it did work for decades. And then how is it possible that all of this is given up so easily in a very short period of time in the last few decades, and now Mexico is falling back completely into becoming pretty much a new colony. So where is that nationalist fervor that you used to have? And I know it's there somewhere. This is what comes to mind. How long are you going to put up with it?
That's a very good point. Jeremy, any thoughts?
Well, lots of thoughts. First of all, thank you all for coming, and I think we should thank the NUT for giving us some space to hold this this afternoon, because the NUT has got a marvellous record on international support for organisations all over the world, in particular teachers and education. We're going to come on to Ayats and Afra a bit later, so I think we should thank the NUT for the help they've given us on this occasion. And also thank everyone that's put together today's event. It is wonderful to have an event for the Day of the Dead, which then does discuss issues facing Mexico at the present time. Lots of thoughts, really. The first is of Mexican history, the pre-Columbian history, the Columbian period, the struggle for independence, and then the struggle for a secular democracy during the early years of independence, the Benito Juarez Constitution of the late 19th century, which was a remarkable document in many, many ways, as he was a truly remarkable individual, and the attempted French invasion, which he beat off and others did, and then the revolution of 1910 and the constitution that left us. And what I find so fascinating about visiting Mexico, Lara, my wife's from Mexico, as you know, so we go there quite a lot, is that there's the sense of understanding of history, respect for that history, and respect for the pre-Spanish, pre-Columbian period, which does not apply anywhere else in North America. It does apply very much in South America, in what we suppose generally call Latin America, but it does apply much more there. And there's this understanding of the diversity of the country, the diversity of language, and the diversity of its history. There's also the brutality of the original Spanish invasion, the brutality of the way in which the hacienda system and the class system operated, and the discrimination that goes with it. There's also, to me, an amazing sense of consciousness, of sense, of pride in the country and being Mexico, and at the same time, this realization of the proximity of the United States, the very close economic relations with the United States, and the complete dominance that the US relationship has over so much of Mexican life, particularly over media. And then at the same time, there is this always bursting cultural expression from people within Mexico trying to build a strong Mexican identity. I'm just reading some of the books of Carlos Fuentes at the moment, and the amazing writings they are too. But the real issue that now has to be faced is quite simply that of the human rights and poverty agenda in Mexico. The numbers of people, as Francisco indicated, who disappeared. The students that were killed at Zanapa were an example, almost a symptom, an appalling symptom of something that is far deeper and very serious within Mexico, and the need for a much stronger human rights agenda, assertion of the powers of the Inter-American Court of Human Rights is important, and also important that the rest of the world doesn't just ignore it. So I'm always surprised that 500,000 people from Britain visit Mexico every year as holidays, on holidays, which is fine. They nearly always go to the Yucatan, they always have a great time, and they come back almost completely unaware of the reality of the rest of Mexico. And now, obviously, you want people to have a good time when they go on holiday, and very happy that Mexico is benefiting from tourism in that way, but I just think we have to be much more aware and much more alive on that. And so the responsibility on all of us to continually raise these issues and raise solidarity and concern, because the numbers of people that have disappeared, the numbers of human rights defenders that have disappeared, and the way in which the legal system seems incapable of getting to the heart of the issue of the problem is a very, very serious one. Last point, the US elections are upon us. The new president will be elected on Tuesday, and the idea that you could have a president who's going to force a country to build a wall around itself to keep the rest of the world away, i.e. the United States, or keep Mexico away from the United States, is beyond bizarre. It is, I think, just appalling, the whole idea of it. It's just totally appalling. The United States has a relationship with Mexico. Millions of Mexicans have made their homes in the United States. And one of the most significant days of protest was when the Mexican community in the USA organized an event called A Day Without Mexicans. like a strike of Mexicans in the USA, and that just drew attention to how much the contribution is to the US economy of migrant workers, mainly from Mexico, but also from other Central American states. So I have a very mixed view of impressions, but above all, my strong impression is the pride in the history, the understanding of the history, and the very powerful secular constitution that exists, and the abilities that constitution should have to deliver the social justice it was designed to deliver.
That's great, thank you very much. And I think you started kind of unwrapping some of the major challenges that I wanted us to get around to. I think what's come across very strongly in all three comments is the United States, right? And this saying by Porfirio Diaz sums it all. So the challenges are more or less there. We've heard about migration, we've heard about the violence, the human rights crisis. And I was really struck by what you were saying, Jeremy, in terms of Mexicans having a strong sense of identity. But at the same time, we have these challenges. How can Mexicans, or if can Mexicans, kind of drawing from experiences of social movements and social uprisings that have happened around the world in the last few years, I mean, the Spring Revolution comes to mind, for example, is change going to come from within Mexico? Can it come from within Mexico? How can Mexicans make the case for social change, for example? Because one of the things that we have experienced is that after the Ayotzinapa case, a lot of us are still remembering and still fighting for this case to be addressed, solved. But many people in Mexico have stopped. They have stopped demonstrating, they have stopped worrying, they have gone back to their daily lives. So how can we trigger this change? Is there any experiences that we can draw from, for example? Anyone wants to jump in on this?
It's the way it is. What I mean by this is the system in Mexico is rotten to the core. And there is a machine that operates daily, and it's a killing machine. I'm thinking very carefully about my words here, but between 2000 and 2011-12, about 170,000 people were assassinated. This is not a result of crime, ordinary crime. This is a result of the mafia, the drug cartels that now control the country. They have, if you look at the various cartels, they have very clearly demarcated territory that they control. And literally, the whole country is divided up among themselves. And when there are clashes because of territory and turf wars, then some killings take place. And I have the very strong impression that they are doing what the Colombians were doing, the drug cartels in Colombia were doing with the Colombian state. Which is this: if you start assassinating anybody, then that's a blackmail on the government to stop fighting the drug cartels. And 170,000, and what you get in Mexico is things such as an open air concert that people go to listen music for. And then suddenly there is a vehicle with machine, somebody with a machine gun, and just shoot at the crowd. And you know, all sorts of people get killed. That is what is going on. 170,000 between 2000 and 2011, and between 2012 and 2015, the information is that 26,000 more have been assassinated. Pinochet, who's the dictator of the country I come from, which is identified as one of the worst things ever, in 17 years, assassinated about 5,000 people. I'm not saying that he was a nice guy, given the figures. But that gives you an idea of what we're talking about. The idea that somebody has the authority, you know, like the students in Ayotzinapa show, to actually just decide to assassinate a good bunch of people in order to send a message, a political message to society, to the rest of, you know, activists in the education system, because they want a different education. This is absolutely horrifying. When you look at the media reaction to this, I don't see repugnance. I see that they report, they don't like it, they make the right noises, but there isn't much that should really wake us up dramatically to this, even though the people in Mexico have been able to create a national movement out of this. So the point I'm trying to make is sometimes you have to get even worse for it to get better. We have demonstrated in Latin America that no matter how difficult it is, no matter how bad the conditions are, no matter how repressive the governments can be, we always come back fighting, and we tend to win, even though sometimes we suffer temporary setbacks, as it is the case now in a few countries. Mexico has all the ingredients, all the components, all the conditions, the historic, the history, the tradition, the revolution in 1917, and so on, in order to be able to fight back. And it's already fighting back. It needs to identify, and this is not for me to tell them what to do, they need to identify a political vehicle through which it will begin its regeneration. It's going to be tough, but it's going to happen.
And we're here to make sure it happens, actually. Yeah. I mean, please feel free to jump in and raise your hands if all of a sudden a burning question comes. The point is for this to be interactive, even though we have pieces of paper on the desk. There are no set presentations to be given, so I will keep my eye out. So just raise your hand if you have any questions for now, especially Mexicans who are prepared to make this happen.
Perhaps I could just draw attention to some of the questions which have come up in Parliament. During Foreign Office questions, as I'm sure many of you are aware who watch the Parliament television show, we have Foreign Office questions every 6 weeks, and every country in the world, obviously, we have various things to ask about, but in particular, there have been questions asked about the rule of law, conditions in prisons, and the instances of torture which are recorded and which human rights defenders have recorded. So there has been an element of holding to account our own government, so that when we're talking about trade, not just talking about trade, but we have a balance of questions that we're asking. And certainly, Emily Thornberry and I, as the leads in the Shadow Foreign Office, will be asking questions about the levels of violence and also about the Inter-American Court on Human Rights, and saying, asking questions about how much progress is being made in relation to that, because from what Francisco has said and the briefings from the House of Commons Library, statements have been made and commitments have been made, but the evidence on the ground from human rights defenders is that there's still a lot of progress to be made about the rule of law, the disappearance of thousands of people, torture in prisons, and just general impunity for a level of violence that I think it's difficult for us to comprehend from here.
Yeah, and I mean, for example, when we started after the case of Ayotzinapa, by the way, if I can see just see a show of hands, who of you here don't know about the case of Ayotzinapa? That's actually a good place to start. Okay, quite a few. Right, so in September 2014, yes? Has it been 2 years? Really? Yes. Wow. Okay. In September 2014, over more than 40 students of the rural school of Ayotzinapa called Isidro Burgos. This is in the state of Guerrero, which is in the western coast of Mexico. This is a rural school where students go to train to be teachers in rural communities. And it has a very historical tradition of being revolutionary, of being very progressive, very left leaning, and it kind of borrows from that tradition of the revolution that Francisco was alluding to. And students from that university were heading to the capital of the state to participate in a demonstration around the 2nd of October, which is traditionally the commemoration of a student uprising which was violently met by the authorities in Mexico. So it's known as the killing of 1968. To get to from Guerrero to this rally, they were traveling in coaches, and as they were traveling through the city of Iguala, they were violently attacked by all combinations of political of police forces, the federal police, the state police, the municipal police. It was all very confusing. Some of them managed to escape. A couple of them, or a few of them, survived. But the reality is that there are still 43 of them missing. Not one, not two, 43. And we still don't know where they are. Now, the Mexican government produced what is now known as the official story, or the official truth, quote unquote, and they decided to argue that the students had in fact ended up in the hands of a drug cartel, and that it's these violent people had taken them and had burned them in a rubbish tip in open air. And they started, and then afterwards they argued that they had put the ashes in bin bags and had chucked these bin bags into a nearby river. And they somehow produced, you know, bags of ashes to support their case. It later emerged, and then they said that two of the perpetrators of this crime had confessed to it. It later emerged that these two perpetrators had given these confessions under torture. And that, and then since then, a series of scientific tests have been carried out through the involvement of the Inter-American Commission for Human Rights and an independent expert panel that they helped put together to try and address this case. They did all series of tests and they said, look, this can't happen. I mean, to burn 43 bodies in open air in a rubbish tip, you'd need to reach a very high temperature. It would be the equivalent of burning, I don't know how many tons of tires, and you would see, you would definitely see that this had happened. There were no traces whatsoever that such a powerful fire had happened. The government has refused to actually investigate properly. There are many leads in the case that they haven't followed, that the group of independent experts has suggested that need to be followed, and they just haven't. And so 2 years later, I had realized that it was actually 2 years, but there you go, 2 years later, we're still in the same situation, right? And then this is just a high profile case. I mean, there are other people who are still looking for relatives who have been forcefully disappeared for years. They don't know where they are, where they have gone. There are grassroots organizations that are emerging, like, for example, Fuerzas Unidas por los Desaparecidos, United Forces for the Disappeared, who are basically relatives who get together looking for their family members. I mean, can you imagine, right? If your mom, your dad, your brother, your sister goes off to work one morning, here in the UK, you will expect them to come back at the end of the day, right? I mean, you will expect that if anything happens to them, the police will do their job and will investigate, and eventually something will happen. So, you know, justice will take place. But that's not really the case in Mexico. As Catherine was quoting, that, you know, there are a lot of questions being asked in terms of levels of torture, levels of violence, human rights violations. This is a reality that Mexicans face. And I think going back to the initial kind of main highlight or main thing that came to mind to all three of you when thinking about Mexico as the United States is that the border with the United States brings a whole load of challenges and issues to Mexico. And if there are no further questions regarding Ayotzinapa or anything around what has come up so far, I'd like us to kind of dig a little bit deeper into what this relationship with the United States brings. So now's your chance.
Yeah.
Yes.
In the regular situation, there was Mario Sandoval Alarcón, who directly controlled the school of the Americans in Chattanooga River,
where they thought the militias to torture people in Latin America.
Can everyone hear us at
that? No. No. You stand in my ears.
You need to be in the microphone.
You need a microphone.
No. Do we have?
I wanted to ask about this American relationship, because it comes and goes with Democrats and Republicans, but I mean, they had somebody, Mario Sandoval Alarcón, who ran the death squads from the Chattanooga River from the School of the Americas, and he operated with Dobie's arm but directly with Klaus Barbie as a result of this. And I mean, there were 60,000 people died in Guatemala, and there was a hell of a lot of trouble. I wonder how directly do we know? How opaque is it? I mean, this goes on. I mean, changes administration, but then it's a kind of invisible government operating. I mean, what do we really know about America's direct interventions? I mean, with their neighbor? I mean, I think it must be some quite complicated military mechanical thing operating under the surface.
Any other questions? Might as well take
them around.
Okay. Would you like to address that?
Yeah. I think there's more than one way of get to the heart of the matter, but it's not only about the militaristic side of the UN or this secret militaristic side of the UN has been pretty effective, or has been pretty effective. I think it's got to do with hegemony. The United States has exerted hegemony over the region for, you know, over 100 years, and it's established a machinery of every kind, including the Venezuelan United States. Here, the treaty of reciprocal assistance that every country feels that they can, under threat of that, they want their troops to help, and so on. And they control the economy. And anybody who deviates from that hegemony and try to do practice some form of nationalism, such as, you know, nationalizing national resources in order to improve the position of the population, then they get overthrown, such as Salvador Allende in Chile in 1970. And when societies go into rebellion in order to shake that off, such as the Central American ones, Nicaragua and Salvador, Guatemala, they unleashed the death squads against them. And your figures have been conservative, actually. In Guatemala, it was 120,000. In 1980 to 1990, and in Salvador it was 80,000. In Nicaragua, if you take everything together, it's about 250,000. So therefore, there is this absolutely atrocious machinery which is prepared to do anything. And in the case of Mexico, to bring that to the particular concrete situation, I'm not sure when the killings began, but, you know, Mexico was not like this. There were some things and misdemeanors, as it were, before. But I think it began with Calderon, roughly around the Calderon presidency, when suddenly the country became, you know, out of control. The cartels began to take control of the situation and the killings and everything deteriorated so dramatically to the point that we are here today. What is extremely concerning, for me at least anyway, is the very fact that Hillary Clinton, and not only her, but many others as well, have been suggesting that what Mexico needs is a sort of Colombia plan. And we know what that did to Colombia. The idea would be to militarize the resolution of the conflict by the United States having a military presence formally in the country through military bases. In the case of Colombia, the United States has 10 military bases as a result of an agreement with Alvaro Uribe, the Defense Cooperation Agreement signed a few years ago. If you read the principles, the clauses in the National Defense, in the Defense Cooperation Agreement, the United States not only legally entitled to use these military facilities which established, you know, in the countries of only Colombia, but it's entitled to use anything that can be used militarily in any situation of conflict, such as civilian airports, ports, hospitals, and any other facility. That's what it says in the actual defense operation. And what Hillary is proposing, sorry, excuse the familiarity, what Hillary Clinton did for us, and can actually do this. The United States hasn't been very keen ever since on this, but it's in the back burner for the time being. And whatever the politicians in the White House and in Washington may say, the fact of the matter is there are very decisive institutions in the United States that operate on their own, regardless of democratic accountability, I suppose is the word, such as the Pentagon, the State Department, and others are very keen to ensure that that is the case. We suffer the consequences of the activities of the US Southcom, the Southern Command, and Mexico falls under the aegis of the North Command, which is more secretive than the Southern Command. We do not know too much about it, but it's as powerful. So therefore, what really this is aimed at securing, sorry, that's too long, but I'll finish with this, aiming at securing is this. Mexico has a relationship with the United States which has total dependency. The level of dependency is absolutely staggering. Mexico imports and exports to and from the United States in the region of 80 to 87%. If you look at the border, the northern border of Mexico with the United States, this is full of maquilas, which are US companies that decided to abandon places such as Detroit, which become in touch with Westlands and other places. They established themselves there to take advantage of lax legislation, terms of wages, regulations, pension, contracts, and so on, which obviously they do. And they have established about 3,000 of them in the border. And this is vital for US companies, absolutely vital. So therefore, any change that takes place within Mexico in a sort of positive sense, such as a nationalistic policy, will jeopardize this. When you look at the figures of, sorry, I'm an economist, so I cannot help this. When you look at the figures of imports and exports, what you see actually is this, a huge amount of parts of, you know, products, electrodomestics, cars and so on, come to Mexico as export from the United States. So they are counted in the national accounts. And then they're assembled in these maquilas, in these companies, by Mexican cheap labor. There's 1 million workers in the whole region. And then they put that together, and then when the finished product is done, this is exported back. It's exported to the United States, which is the only in the first place. And they appear in the accounts as exports of Mexico. So when you say 80, 85, 87, this is very fake. In other words, the dependency is so intense. And the dependency is even worse when you look at the agreement that Clinton forced on Mexico when Mexico, the Mexican peso collapsed in 1995, in December 1994, January 1995, when Bill Clinton, not Hillary in this case, used his presidential special royal rights to take money from the reserves of the United States and lend them to Mexico to the tune of $53 billion in 1 week. And up to that point, Mexico had accumulated an external debt of $100 billion. So in 1 week, it increased by 50% as a result of the North American Free Trade Agreement. That's what happened. And in order to ensure that Mexico actually did pay later on, all the money is coming from the oil revenues that Mexico was exporting and getting were actually banked in the Federal Reserve Bank in order to make sure. So if there was any independence in Mexico up to that point, after that, it went. So you can imagine, it couldn't be more convenient from the point of view of US capital, even though it's declining. That relationship is amazing. So anything that complicates it is going to suffer the wrath of those vested interests. I hope that it wasn't too open. I think it's necessary.
Definitely. Just to clarify, I mean, yes, so violence has always been there in Mexico, but it definitely got a lot worse since Mexico signed the Plan Merida, which is this idea, I think, jointly developed with the United States in terms of how to start dismantling drug cartels, right, where they went. Similar to what they did in Colombia, they went after the kingpins, but when the kingpins were kind of taken out of the picture, then they dispersed and formed newer and smaller cartels. And so rather than concentrating a lot of violence into one single group, there's a lot of violence into smaller groups. And because they are no longer as profitable as they once were, just dealing or trading drugs, they have now diversified into kidnapping and other forms of violence to kind of stay afloat. So I think that's one of the reasons why the violence has escalated so much over the last almost eight, 10 years probably. So that's definitely the case.
Can I add one?
Sure, shall we let Catherine maybe come in, or
let me finish on that. I wanted to talk about violence against women.
Yes.
Yeah. So let me
yes, okay, Francisco, then.
Which is part of the North American Free Trade Agreement. It's very comprehensive, we don't have much time, but it's quite important to understand that dependency, dependent relationship. Mexico abandoned the protection of its industry, and particularly for its agricultural sector. The United States has the most productive agriculture in the world and is the most heavily subsidized agricultural sector in the world. If you go to any supermarket and you find that long grain US rice is cheaper than basmati, this is not possible. You know, the wages of Indian agriculturists is so, they're so low. And the wages of people who work in the agriculture sector in the US are very high. It is not possible for US long grain rice to be cheaper than basmati. But go to any supermarket and you see what I'm telling you. And the reason is it's heavily subsidized. Mexico abandoned the protection of its own agricultural sector, as a result of which the United States flooded Mexico with maize and with beans. And it's incredible. Mexico invented maize and beans. How is it possible that actually it's flooded by US cheap, you know, US beans and rice and maize? And this is what is destroying the economy. And as a result of it, people leave their agricultural sector, go to Mexico City for work, they cannot find any, so they end up in the north where they expect money to find something in Maquilas. They don't, so they cross the border. And then they, now they have to deal with Trump.
Yes, exactly.
I wanted just to mention the position of women, because it's always crucial to look at women's position as well in the case of human rights. And both in the States, where a lot of women have migrated from Mexico, I think there's a struggle there for recognition and basic workers' rights. And we know that when Obama did some changes to the immigration law, that there were women who came from Mexico who were very pleased about the fact that there were some improvements there on immigration law. Probably not enough to go far enough, but it's important to put on record some of the positive changes that were made recently in relation to migrant women. However, I would imagine in Las Maquilas, the position of women working in manufacturing, textiles, and electricity goods, electrical goods, is probably something that needs to be worked on. And perhaps with some trade union colleagues in the room, we could think about some solidarity projects to develop the position of women. On sexual violence and sadly, killings and abductions, there is a lot to be reported in the literature, and I'm sure Lucy would know of some examples as well. But just to be a little bit positive as well, otherwise we might go away from this night of celebration feeling a bit negative, but I understand that in parts of Morelos, the gender alert scheme is one which is designed to mobilise authorities and combat gender-based violence. And this is something which women themselves have come up with, and perhaps this is something which, once again, trade union colleagues could ask how that's being spread in other states, not just in Morelos. And also I think following quite a high profile event in the US border town of Ciudad Juarez, where some women were killed tragically. As a result of that, I understand that a lot of women have begun to organize. And once again, I think this is a challenge for us who are in the trade union movement, who want to support women, perhaps to focus on some of these local grassroots initiatives which are working, and see how we can support those so that we can support women in those situations. don't know if you want to add anything to that.
Well, I'll add also that, you know, kind of the, and it's brilliant that you brought it up, because I was asking, actually, that was going to be one of my next topics, particularly following up from what Francisco was saying around Maquilas, right, and all these northern towns, it's women. Because the impact of the relationship, unbalanced relationship with the United States is inevitably going to be felt differently by different social groups and gender, right? And women, invariably, wherever you are, whatever the situation is, women are always worse off, right? So that really needs to be addressed in Mexico and all over the world. And if you have any involvement here or say on, for example, the SDGs and the high level panel for women's, for human rights for women, for example, one of the asks that a lot of the women's rights organization have is more funding for women's rights organizations. Because if women are starting to organize at the front line, starting to support each other, I mean, they need as many resources as they can get. And hopefully that will set the ball rolling, right? But definitely, yeah.
Jeremy. Can I just add a couple of things? First of all, thank Catherine for what she just said. Mexico has the 16th highest rate of any country in the world of women's homicide, which when you think of the number of countries in the world and the relative sizes, that is a horrifying figure. There is a horrendous rate of domestic violence in Mexico, which much of which is unreported, as indeed it's unreported in other places. And whilst there are women's organizations, often very effective ones in some of the cities, I suspect in other areas it is simply not the case. And the violence and abuse towards women is appalling in those places as well. And so I think the points that everyone's making really about support for women's organizations, it is in Britain's international development strategy to support women's organizations far as possible. There is no aid program to Mexico for reasons of Mexico's relative economic strength compared to other countries. But there are some facilities where Britain could support human rights organizations and representation organizations. And what I'd be grateful for, and I'm sure Catherine would as well, is any ideas that anyone has here of what you would want us to be doing about this in Parliament and whatever we do in the future in developing policies towards Latin America, because I'm very keen that we should configure foreign policy around human rights and peace and democracy. This government has got rid of most, if not all, of the human rights advisors that were present in a lot of British embassies. Most have gone and been replaced by investment advisors, which means that the focus of Britain's foreign policy relationship with countries is entirely commercial rather than political or humanitarian. I think, of course, there's a commercial relationship, there's bound to be, but I think we should set as a very important role with that of human rights and human rights law. The points on the relationship with the USA, and Francisco mentioned the Plan Merida, which George W. Bush signed, and that was controversial in Mexico because there is a very clear line that no foreign troops should ever be stationed in Mexico. That's a constitutional position, and there is an argument about whether or not US special advisors constitute foreign troops there. The Merida Accord ties Mexico into a great deal of money from the United States in chasing down drug dealing, which doesn't appear to have been terribly effective in that area. There's also, quite rightly pointed out, the question of NAFTA, and the trend across North America is a truly scary one. The northern states of the USA, I'm talking here Illinois, Michigan, Wisconsin, traditionally very strong manufacturing base, traditionally very strong trade union base, and very powerful unions at that, particularly in the auto industry and the steel industry, have declined somewhat because of imports from mainly China and the Far East, to a lesser extent from Europe. There was then the right-to-work states, which are anything but the right-to-work. It's absolutely an abusive language to call it the right-to-work. The idea was that industries will be attracted away from the northern states and southern states of the USA by deregulation, by less pension contributions or no pension contributions. And on that basis, quite a lot of the auto industry then moved to southern states, Alabama and Georgia and other states. The NAFTA agreement and the protection of foreign companies working in the border areas has undermined even the right to work states. And so you have a trend of going from a process of skilled, unionized, relatively high paid labor, bitterly fought for, it must be said, over 30 or 40 years, but nevertheless that was the case around the Great Lakes states, moving to the southern states of the USA, and then in turn moving to Mexico. And the relationship between Mexico and the USA on NAFTA, North American Free Trade Association, is hardly fair and equitable. For example, Mexican-owned vehicles are not allowed to go more than 100 kilometers away from the border in the USA, and many are not allowed to go at all. And so the idea being that the transport and trucking arrangements are for the benefit of the USA rather than Mexico. And as Francisco quite rightly pointed out, the manufacturing arrangements mirror that as well. And so when we're talking of trade relations, and you hear exaggerated claims of what the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership would do between Europe and the United States, I urge anyone who thinks that to read a potted history of the North American Free Trade Association agreement to get an idea of what the problems are from that kind of trade agreement.
Definitely, and again, you know, seeing this from the point of view of all the different social groups and the impact it's going to have, right? Right, I've got quite a few questions. Right, okay. We can't really.
Can't use
microphone. Maybe sorry, but we talk a bit about the trafficking trade and how that works, more pressure can be done internationally, because obviously we talk about the drug trade, but also trafficking, human trafficking. But also in terms of trade, if we're, you know, with Brexit, what pressure can you put a country if there's going to be other trade deals set up on about human rights in Mexico and America? Could pressure be to do?
Okay, so a question about trade agreements and trafficking and what's that being done, right? Mariana?
So I was really pleased to hear the panel speak about women and women's rights. I think in terms of what, can you hear me?
You probably need to come a bit closer.
We like a roving mic, so we need roving people.
I think, I was very pleased to hear you speak both about women's rights. Okay, now I've just gone too late. About women's rights in Mexico, and also support to women's rights organizations. I think in terms of what you can do and recommendations for what you can do, one thing I would say, I work for a women's rights organization, international women's rights organization here in London, has to do with the National Action Plan on Women, Peace and Security. So as you know, the UK government is in the process of developing the new National Action Plan. This is based on the UNSCR Resolution 1325. And I think there's two main things that I would recommend. One is that there's greater consultation with local women's rights organizations. So luckily, after some asking from civil society, the FCO has just provided, I think it's £60,000 to do some consultations on the ground and ask women's rights organizations in conflict-affected countries what it is that they would want and need. So I think one has to do with, you know, making sure that these women from conflict-affected countries have a voice and that their voices are heard and, you know, are seen in the plans developed by this government. And a second thing I think would have to do with how do we talk and conceptualize security. So like, what is security, right? So like, again, is Mexico considered a conflict-affected country? Probably not, right? Like, by definition. But then when we hear about the number of deaths, both like in general and also, you know, femicides or the death of Muslim women, maybe we should be talking about. So I think these are two things that, you know, right now in your positions, you know, as a leader of your position and you know, FCO, like shadow minister, I think these are two things that you can definitely push the government to do.
Sure, thank you.
Thank you, Mariana. Right, so I'm going in order, James?
On a slightly different topic, is that?
Yeah,
it's
Yeah, sorry. It's if you want to ask a question, you have to put yourself in the spot.
Well, it's really on how you see the struggling Mexico and the developments in relation to the rest of Latin America, where there have clearly been some, you know, quite seriously negative developments. If we look at the coup in Brazil and the election in Argentina, the offensive against the elected president in Venezuela, obviously the changes within Cuba are ongoing as well, in a sort of more positive way. But so just to see how you see all of those things relating to what's happening in Mexico, and also to give a bit of a plug, because there is the Latin America conference that happens every year on the 26th of November, and there's always a very good discussion on Mexico at that, but it also situates, you know, puts all of these things together in terms of the overall thing, so that's it.
And there's one last question, and I think it's best if we take this last one and then we do one last round. And would you like to come up? And as you come up, yes, Justice Mexico now will be hosting a panel at the Latin America conference. That was a plug for the end, but I'll just bring it in now.
Yeah. I'm not sure this is a question, but I just wanted to say something that what happened, obviously with Calderon, President Calderon, things got really out of control, as you were saying. But what happened before Calderon wasn't quite misdemeanors. What I think what has to be very clear is after Calderon started the war on drugs, it has become so incomprehensible that we have paid more attention. But before that, we had, well, the massacre of 1968. We had the dirty war of the 70s, where a lot of people were disappeared or thrown from airplanes in the sea. We had Artea, where people were murdered, 45 people, mostly women and children, praying. We had Abaslanca. So it's not that things started with Calderon. They became incomprehensible in the degree of barbarity, but the brutality has been in Mexico on and on and on and on forever. So I think it's very hard to understand the dimensions of it in a country like the UK. So I think we have been talking a lot about the relationship with the United States, obviously, because it's very important, but I think if we are in the UK, we really, really need for a government to question the Mexican government openly in any event that has to do publicly with Mexico, like receiving the president, for instance, or all these things the British Museum has been doing for the Day of the Dead. I feel that in the past few years, the UK government is becoming very friendly with Mexico, which is great, of course, it's nice that they recognize the good things of your country, but it's not being vocal openly enough, saying, look, you are murdering people in a horrendous scale, and I think any government in this country, no matter what commercial interest they have in Mexico, has to really challenge the Mexican government, because I think they only care about international opinion. Sadly, they don't care about the opinion of the people inside the country.
That's a really important one that I was going to make just now, so thank you. Is Kai? Yes?
Yeah, just following on that comment. It's important to stress the role of the UK in this human rights situation in Mexico, because last year, for instance, there was an increase in 6,000% in arms exports from the UK to Mexico. So we need to talk not only about the dependence of Mexico in relation to the US, but also to give a name to this dependence, which is a form of colonialism, and also talk about the colonialism, British colonialism. For instance, BP, British Petroleum, is now having access to Mexico's oil after the privatization of natural resources by Enrique Peña Nieto. And HSBC in London has been reported to be a central piece in money laundering for Mexican drug cartels. So we need to talk about the colonialism that is going on in relation to countries like Mexico, but not only from the US, but also from the UK. The 2015 year was labeled the dual year of Mexico in the UK and the UK in Mexico, and that means that Cameron welcomed Peña Nieto, as Sofina said, but also that Peña Nieto was in Edinburgh to close deals with the British companies interested in Mexico's oil. As Francisco was saying before, there's a very long conflict that goes back to the North American Free Trade Agreement, which is basically about the dispossession of natural resources in Mexico. And planned marriage is just an extension, it's just a military extension of the Free Trade Agreement, because to achieve the dispossession of natural resources, you need to displace people from their communities so that you can have access to the natural resources, to water, to oil, to the rainforest, etc., etc. Mining companies, for instance, most of them are from Canada, so now British companies want to go there to exploit Mexico's natural resources. So, just following on this, I think that we need to discuss the role of the UK, because asking the question of if change can come from within, or if Mexican people has to learn something from other movements, I think that if we look at the Free Trade Agreement and all that happened from since 1994, we had incredible movements of resistance in Mexico that we need to support. And these movements have been raising up against the dispossession of natural resources and against the violence that has been produced by these international agreements. But in order to understand that, we need to be clear, this is not only a relation of dependence, this is a form of neocolonialism based on the exploitation and dispossession of natural resources. So I think that we need to push a little bit forward this argument. And also just the last thing, we are talking about the relationship between Mexico and the US, but we need to talk about the role of the Mexican politicians because they haven't resisted to these very violent policies for militarization coming from the US. They have willingly subordinated Mexico to the U.S. foreign policies. So we need to talk in order to challenge this relationship between Mexico and the U.S., we need to talk about the movements challenging the Mexican government within Mexico.
Thank you. Right, okay. So I think in the interest of time, let's do the last round. Catherine, would
Stand on the last point first about the natural resources, because we should also just remember the indigenous population. Even though I think things have improved a bit since the Las Chiapas in the early 90s, I'm sure there are still things which we can ask questions about. And I know that the Foreign Commonwealth Office has a particular work stream on indigenous people. So I think that's something which we can ask and push on. So I'm very happy to do that. And also wanted to raise the question of just London as a financial centre, and a lot of the questioning that we've begun to ask is around, well, it's very wide-ranging, but it starts with our overseas territories as tax havens, but it goes all the way through to what we're doing around banking regulation here to clamp down on lots of things, but terrorism-related financing, guns and weapons related financing, but also we must, as you've very well mentioned tonight and reminded us, talking about the relationship between our banking and drugs. Because when you look at last April when the revelations came out from the Mossack Fonseca, there was an awful lot of drug money wrapped up in the way that financial institutions basically pass money from one place to the other without asking the questions that should be asked. So thank you very much for reminding us about that. And we should include that whenever we talk about our approach to cleaner finance, which is something which both our Shadow Treasury team are developing in a lot of detail, and the Overseas Territories is within my brief, but also the Shadow Foreign Office. And we're doing quite a lot of work on how we can ensure that what happens right here in London can be much cleaner and can be much fairer to other developing countries. Briefly, just on the other question which was raised about the Foreign Office, money for conflict zones and women's development and consulting with women on new plans. I'm very happy also to raise whether countries like Mexico can be included in that, because even though there hasn't necessarily been a war in the same way as there is in Middle East countries, you could easily argue that the levels of violence have the same impact they would have had there been a war. And also we know that just the high number of guns in Mexico means that, you know, it's a warlike situation in some very significant trouble spots. So once again, very happy to ask what work streams there are within the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, and also to raise the question consistently, which Jeremy has mentioned, that our current policies are very focused on trade, almost exclusively, and what we seek to do is have the balance between trade, human rights and security. But those three things are not at all in balance. It's all trade, 90% and 5% for the other two. And they're things which I think we genuinely need to have a much more balanced approach. I'm going to let Francisco answer the question on that.
Yeah. Just a little bit more of this is every year the number of journalists that are assassinated in the world is reduced. And Mexico has always the largest figure. And what is uncomfortable, I'm trying to use the correct word here, is that nobody in the media discusses it. It's never there. If there is a country that the media may not like, and something happens to any journalist, it would be all over the place. But Mexico consistently, year in, year out, has the largest number of journalists assassinated, and yet no outcry. So therefore, there is an issue which means this. There is an issue which is this. Somehow, state institutions in Mexico either are not willing or are incapable of actually doing something about this. Because whenever there is a killing, there should be an investigation, there should be some arrests, some serious matters. And they don't seem to happen in Mexico. So if there is anything that the authorities in Mexico can be made accountable for, precisely on failure to uphold its own legislation, doesn't mean to say, you know, governments control everything, they don't necessarily. So that's one thing, and secondly, what movements are demanding from inside Mexico is something that we should respond to more than anything. You know, the case of Argentina, obviously, to me is the obvious one, but it's not the only one, it's symbolic. Interestingly, in the case of Argentina, when they realized, the investigators, that actually there was, these people were possibly in a mass grave, they began to look for mass graves, and they discovered too many. And they stopped digging, because you know, there's just too many for them to be able to say, Jesus Christ. They were discovering mass grave after mass grave after mass grave. So there's been massacre after massacre after massacre taking place, God knows for how long. So therefore, there is something very dramatically bad and seriously wrong about all of this. I want to deal with the question of, you know, how Mexico fits in the overall Latin American perspective. I think this is crucial. Mexico seems to be trapped in this US embrace, which is so strong that it cannot get out of it. You know, 80-something% imports, 80-something% exports, it's just too much. There doesn't seem to be anything, plus the flooding of cheap products from the United States, plus the industrialization of Mexico as a result of the elimination of any tariff barriers, you know, in the border between the two countries, certainly from the United States. And the result has been, you know, the internal collapse of the country. So therefore, this is a very complicated matter in that sense. What it means is that it's unlikely that Mexico is going to be joining the rest of the progressive governments in the region in the future. However, the social movements and progressive organizations and so on that are emerging on a mass base in Mexico, there is no question about it, they're very, very mass base. they definitely will be part of that future possibility. Developments in Latin America are extremely bad. A coup d'etat in Brazil, you know, the biggest giant, is an industrial, economic giant that shifted the wrong way. And therefore, leave the process of regional integration pretty complicated, to put it mildly. And the very fact that Argentina, you know, another one of the big ones in the region economically, has gone also the wrong way. It's another complication. So you have Mexico, Brazil, and Argentina, three powerful economies in the region, shift to the right. Then everything we were trying to do up to recently succeeds substantially, complicated. And add to that, the very fact that those progressive nations or countries or governments that still exist are under attack, massive attack. You know, certainly many of them. And this is not going to stop. And it seems to me that we waited for 30 years, we endured 30 years of horrible neoliberalism after Pinochet in all Latin America, and we produced the pink card, pink wave, as it's known, all these left progressive governments all over the place, which did wonders. In 2004, the level of poverty in Latin America as a whole was in the region of 48-44% of the total. That was more than 250 million people. And last year, the Economic Commission for Latin America produced a result report on 10 years of progressive policies in most of the countries in the region. And the level of poverty now is 26%. So about 100 million people have been taken out of poverty. This is just only one decade. So that shows what is possible. And that shows that, you know, any country that's going the wrong way is going to produce no only resistance, but it's going to set the country back quite dramatically. The privatization of the energy sector in Mexico is not going to be dramatic, I'm afraid. I wish it would, but it's not going to be. And the reason is Mexico's oil reserves are very small. They are going to last 30 years, maybe 40 years. From the point of view of the US, this is peanuts. So therefore, it's the symbolism of getting away with privatizing, which I think matters, especially, you know, that industry which was so emblematic in the nation of nationalism. So what I expect is to happen, and I hope this is not prophecy necessarily, is that the resistance, both in Brazil, which is really taking place in a big way, you know, particularly young people, but also in Argentina, where there have been several strikes. Both countries are moving towards organized and general strikes as we speak. So I imagine that this is going to mean that we don't have to wait for 30 years to come back and retake the road to progress, social progress, and democracy as we were. But it's going to be tough.
Any final thoughts?
Yes. Seven, but very quickly.
Okay.
Before you get alarmed.
Seven fit into about 29.
First of all, the issue that Jenny raised about human rights and issues surrounding that, as indeed others did as well. When the Eisenhower 43 disappeared, there was then a lot of international pressure, a lot of pressure in Mexico, massive demonstrations. Indeed, I was in Mexico City during the weekend shortly after. I've never seen such big demonstrations ever before, like millions of people on the streets. Suddenly it's all, not suddenly, but over time that seems to have reduced. When they were searching for the alleged graves of the 43, they kept on coming across unmarked gravesite after unmarked gravesite all along the coast. And what were they turning up? Were bodies of mainly Guatemalan women who had been trying to travel from Guatemala, Nicaragua, Honduras, El Salvador, through Mexico in order to get to the United States, in order to try and work and try and send money home. And that is the tragedy of the migrant route and the tragedy of the poverty of Central America and this relationship between the USA and Central America. And many of those were killed because their families couldn't provide the money that the gangs demanded from them. Because in an era of mobile phones, it's very easy to trace back to somebody where they've come from try and demand money from them. And the tragedy of the migrant peoples is something that is continuing, often ignored by the world's media, and just goes on and on. And it's nearly always the poorest, most vulnerable women who suffer because of that. And the any journalist who speaks up about this is in grave danger. There are a number of books that have been written by very brave people who've had to go into exile because they've written about the relationship of the gangs and the injustice that goes on. So I think we should support our own NUJ and what it does in standing up for international journalists as well as the International Journalists Organization. On the trade arrangements that we make with Mexico, after Britain has left the European Union, Britain will have to make its own trade arrangements with the rest of the world. Now, I obviously hope there's going to be market access in Europe and a proper trading arrangement with Europe for this country. But it also means that we have to have trade arrangements with the rest of the world. Now, the European Union has negotiated all our trade arrangements for the last 40 years, and all of them include a human rights clause. In most cases, the human rights clause is not particularly well enforced, if enforced at all. So far as I'm concerned, I want to look at trade arrangements in the future that do something to improve environmental conditions, don't export pollution from this country to somewhere else by regulating pollution, polluting industries in this country, but importing from non-regulated polluting industries elsewhere. That's just that instead of polluting rivers in Britain, that's just polluting rivers somewhere else. I think we have to use our trade power, insofar as it is, to try to ensure that we improve those conditions, as well as obviously the contribution we would make to the WTO on that. So even in opposition, we're working very hard on this at the moment, the kind of trade arrangements we want to make in the future. On the point about support for NGOs, I think it's important to remember that there are very effective non-governmental organizations in Mexico dealing with human rights, monitoring human rights abuses, trying to support human rights defenders, and that is important, but it's also looking at the legal system in Mexico and the experiment in adversarial justice which has been introduced in some parts of Mexico, which I think is basically a good thing. I do think that an adversarial court process is far better than an investigating magistrate process, which is open to all kinds of pressure, whereas an adversarial process I think is much stronger because both sides' arguments have to be tested in open court rather than by what can become quite private forms of correspondence. Mexico's relationship with the rest of the continent, what's I always find strange going to Mexico is that how little journalistic or media coverage there is of anything else in anywhere in Latin America. You go to a country in South America, Peru, Bolivia, Venezuela, Ecuador, you'll find an awful lot of public discussion about the relations with neighbors with other countries, and there's a kind of identity around it. In Mexico, you just don't get the same feeling at all. It is either Mexico or it's Europe and the USA that's reported rather than countries to the south, even though Mexico, of course, grew out of the, or modern Mexico, grew out of the Spanish colonization of the whole of Central America, when it was administered in colonial times as one great region. The other strange juxtaposition is we've talked a lot about human rights abuses in Mexico. I'm glad somebody mentioned the 1968 massacre when several hundred people were shot dead by military and police forces in Mexico City. It is still a scandal. The survivors of it still meet together. Indeed, I've met some of the survivors of it. That was at the time of the Olympics in Mexico. But at the same time, Mexico has also been a place of safety. There is a beautiful memorial stone in Veracruz to the Spanish Republicans who came to make their homes in Mexico in 1938 when fascism overtook Spain. And there are many from El Salvador, many from Chile and other places that did gain a place of safety in Mexico, notwithstanding the human rights abuses that happened in Mexico. And indeed, there is that tradition there. The political process in Mexico is based on the 1917 constitution, which was introduced after the end of the war there and was trying to go beyond what had become a virtual dictatorship up until 1910 in Mexico. So no re-election was allowed to any one political position in Mexico. So in other words, if you went to the Congress, you do your congressional term and then you're not allowed to stand again for the same position. The same applies to the Senate, same applies to governorships and any other elected public office. Now, at one level, that sounds very democratic, but in reality, I know this from long experience, the one thing that concentrates the minds of elected representatives is the prospect of re-election or non-re-election. And it does concentrate the mind a great deal, I can assure you. Listen to the chat around the House of Commons the whole time. And so there are moves to bring in re-election, not for president, but for Senate and Congress. It hasn't gone through yet, but I suspect it probably will come through. And I think actually that would generally be a good thing, because at the moment, a person is elected, say, to Congress, they cease being a member of Congress. They then go off and try and be elected as a mayor or a governor or a senator. So there's a sort of merry-go-round of often a relatively small political grouping, whereas I think there has to be a much wider political grouping. And I just think it's an interesting argument and process that goes on. But I think on this, the Day of the Dead, or just after the Day of the Dead, we should remember those that have gone before, but also have such fantastic respect for the cultural heritage and traditions of Mexico that go way back before the Aztec or the Maya times. It was the civilizations that were there before, the pyramids that are there from long, long before the Aztec or the Maya civilizations took over, and that incredible sense of learning that was there at all that time and was never actually completely suppressed by the Spanish occupation, and that strength of the cultural identity of Mexico is something that I absolutely admire and love very much, and we should also understand that. And when we have relations with another country, as we have to have, let's have those relations on the basis of respect for the history and respect of what's gone there before, but also have those relations on the basis that if we, all of us, believe in the universality of human rights, as we do, and we want to live in a pollution-free or sustainable environment, then it's up to us to do something about both of those things in all the relationships that we have. That means being self-critical as well as critical of others, and I think this evening's conversation has been, to me anyway, very instructive and valuable. And if you have views or ideas you want to put to us, send them to Catherine and to me. I'm very happy to try and take them on board, because politics has got to be, always got to be, a participatory, above all, a learning process. So could we thank also those that have put together tonight's event, and we're all going to enjoy it tomorrow this afternoon.